IT response, healthcare workers, emergency responders, truck drivers, construction workers, and retail store employees. Those affected by violence and natural disasters, all of our first responders, those recovering from surgery, those who are battling chronic illness, depression, cancer, all of our shut-ins, those who retire from the nursing homes, those without a food or shelter, those who are imprisoned or enslaved, those who are seeking employment. So I think we're going now to O Canada, and we'll invite you to rise, but we'll just listen to the room. Have the words up on the screen for us this morning. Swords into plowshares, and their spears into pruning hooks. Nation shall not rise against nation, neither shall they learn war anymore. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us unite our hearts in prayer. Let us pray. O God, at this annual time of remembrance, our thoughts turn to the violence, fear, and pain of war. Come gently into our worship this morning, that we may know your peace, not the peace of violence ignored and fear repressed, but the true peace of evil confronted, injustice exposed, and reconciliation achieved. We pray in the name of the Prince of Peace. Amen. Now we pray as Christ taught us, saying together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those that trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Now we're going to hear again from our singers.
Thank you.
Bill has agreed to read that for us this morning.
In Flanders fields of poppies blow, between the crosses, row on row. The mark our place, and in the sky the larks still bravely singing fly, scarce heard amid the guns below. We are the dead. Short days ago we lived, felt dawn, saw sunset glow, loved and were loved, and now we lie in Flanders fields. Take up our quarrel with the foe. To you from failing hands we throw the torch. Be yours to hold it high. If he break faith with us who die, we shall not sleep, though poppies grow in Flanders fields.
Thanks, Bill. But we sometimes have trouble waiting. We experienced that in the past week. But we look to God for patience in times when waiting seems hard. We can be thankful for the opportunities, for giving that continue even during these difficult times. And your morning offerings will now be presented. And Bruce is going to bring them up for us this morning. Present to you our offerings with sincere love and a longing for justice to flow throughout the world. Accept these gifts, O Lord. Use them for your glory and care for the poor. We pray in Christ's name. Amen.
I'm not sure if we did a Google here work.
Yeah. We're going to listen to this dedication song.
First Thessalonians chapter 4, verses 13 to 18. But we do not want you to be uninformed, brothers and sisters, about those who have died, so that you may not grieve as others do, who have no hope. For since we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so, through Jesus, God will bring with him those who have died. For this we declare to you by the word of the Lord, that we who are alive, we who are left until the coming of the Lord, will be by no means those who have died. For the Lord himself, with the cry of command, with the archangel's call, and with the sound of God's trumpet, will descend from heaven. And the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are alive, who are left, will be caught up in the clouds together with them to meet the Lord in the air. And so we will be with the Lord forever. Therefore, encourage one another with these words.
Thanks, Peter. Our second reading is from Matthew 25. It's kind of a different reading for Remembrance Day Sunday. Then the kingdom of heaven will be like this. 10 bridesmaids took their lamps and went to meet the bridegroom. 5 of them were foolish, 5 were wise. When the foolish took their lamps, they took no oil with them, but the wise took flasks of oil with their lamps. As the bridegroom was delayed, all of them became drowsy and slept. But at midnight there was a shout, "Look, here is the bridegroom. Come out to meet him." When all those bridesmaids got up and trimmed their lamps, the foolish said to the wise, "Give us some of your oil, for our lamps are going out." But the wise replied, "No, there will not be enough for us and for you. You had better go to the dealers and buy some for yourselves." And while they went to buy it, the bridegroom came. And those who were ready went with him into the wedding banquet, and the door was shut. Later, the other bridesmaids came also, saying, "Lord, Lord, open to us." But he replied, "Truly I tell you, I do not know you. Keep awake, therefore, for you know not, neither the day nor the hour." The word of the Lord. Well, as we approach Remembrance Day, it's appropriate for us to be thinking of those in our history who were able to stay at their post and were prepared to pay the cost to fight for freedom for our country. However, the reading from Matthew is really a more inward-looking passage for church people. There are really two questions that any community of faith could ask of themselves. First, what is the Spirit of God doing in the world? And second, what can the church do to cooperate with this action? There are two basic questions we can profitably spend time with. We can claim to be God-loving folks, but are we actively seeking the kingdom? This morning's reading is at least confusing, if not actually hard to understand. I know I'm not the only one who's wondered what Jesus was talking about. It could be that those 5 bridesmaids were being set up as a horrible example. I read of a similar idea out of New York City. Some stores actually hire crooks for a price. They go in and steal without worrying about jail. In fact, they aren't punished at all. The people at Theft, T-H-E-F-T, specialize in crooks. And for a fee, they will be loaned to you at any size, age, or any shape you like. A thief is hired with as much fanfare as any new employee, and after a few days on the job, they're caught stealing. And with a great deal of shouting and screaming, he gets fired, and the other employees hopefully get the message. As the page in the website said, our people are prepared to take as much scolding and humiliation as the employer may want to use. The director of Theft, the honest employer fooling thieves, see if you can remember that one, which he runs out of her home in Bayshore, says, hire someone to fire. The idea is it's much better for the employer to fire an undercover employee for stealing and get the message out rather than losing otherwise valued employees. So it could be that the early church was remembering the story of Jesus as getting the troops to smarten up. The message is, if you don't shape up, Jesus may return and leave you out in the cold. Well, the problem with that message is it doesn't sound much like Jesus, the Jesus we've come to know and to love. In this particular story, half of the bridesmaids foul up. Now, being the survivor of many different weddings gone awry, that appears to be no big deal. They are with the bride. They're anticipating the bridegroom coming and taking her home with him. These bridesmaids didn't bring extra oil, and when the bridegroom arrived later than expected, everybody's schedule had been thrown off. They take the suggestion of the bridesmaid who had the extra oil. Go to an oil dealer, buy your own. And when they do that, they return and find the doors locked to them. Well, whose fault is this crisis anyway? A case can be made to blame the bridegroom. First of all, we're told he's late. In my officiating experience, it's rarely the groom that comes late. But the one in the story should realize that his late arrival causes a crisis. And secondly, when the bridesmaids return, he won't let them back in. He set up this situation that takes no responsibility for it. So you could name him as the party pooper in the story. But we could blame also those so-called wise bridesmaids. They're foolish, they're selfish with their oil. And more to the point, they kind of set up the other bridesmaids, telling them to rush out and buy more oil. It's dangerous at night for women outside. There's no oil dealers nearby, I'm sure. So surely Christian charity would suggest that those who have the oil should share selflessly with those who have none. They would eliminate the risk. So they too have a hand in ruining the party. And yet the story doesn't appear to blame either the insensitivity of the bridegroom or the selfishness of the bridesmaids with the extra oil. The story leads us to the conclusion that it's those so-called foolish bridesmaids who should bear the blame for the outcome of the story. Doesn't that bother you? I know it can be. After all, haven't we all been guilty of poor planning? Haven't we found ourselves in the wrong place at the wrong time, maybe even on the wrong side of a locked door? It's human, isn't it? If we're fortunate, someone with a sense of mercy or a sense of humor relents and we're restored to the place we want to be. There's no grace or humor revealed here. They're locked out of that party. So obviously we have to look a bit deeper. What gives? I have no great wisdom on the parable, but I do have some crazy wedding experiences. I had one wedding where the bride started to have doubts on the day. So instead of having the bridesmaid put her in a hammerlock rope hold, we had decided to go outside and have a talk. And eventually she kind of calmed down and decided that, maybe the groom was the man for her after all. The bride really had only one job, to show up for the day, but she let go of her post. Maybe that was the problem with those foolish slackers. They didn't go wrong by their failure to provide the extra oil. It wasn't their fault that they had fallen asleep, because we're told that everybody fell asleep, but they missed their mission. Job one was to welcome that bridegroom with joy. And when that critical moment arrived, they had abandoned their post. Indeed, they were foolish. They acted as if their job was to have oil in their lamps, to find it if it lacked. But that wasn't their primary task. Their primary job was to welcome the bridegroom, communicate joy between the bride and the bridegroom. They were heralds of unbelievably good news. And in that case, they failed in their task. Now, some commentators see this parable as a veiled criticism of the religious authorities of Jesus' day, those that we would call scribes and Pharisees, or the priests. Their chief task was not to keep the temple beautiful or profitable. Their chief task was to keep the people connected with God, to greet that prophetically promised arrival of God with joy. But when Jesus arrived, they viewed him as a nuisance, interfering with the temple's profitability or threatening its well-being. They confused the means with the ends. Indeed, they ended up sacrificing the ends to the means. In their anxiety to keep their own lamps burning, they abandoned their posts and didn't welcome Jesus with joy. So how do we keep awake in our own day? I think we need to take note of the parable's implications for us. Our task is not to preserve our religion, but rather to communicate joy. The joy of knowing Jesus Christ. The joy of his victory over sin and death. The joy of his presence with us and of his final return. Samuel Massey looked at joylessness from his Presbyterian context. He asked his congregation to think about this question. Do our lives, our individual congregations, even our denominations, radiate joy? So I'm going to borrow a bit from him this morning as we face some of those same questions. Massey writes, in a nation where so many believe in God and so many are on spiritual quests, why are the mainline churches shrinking? Without any scientific evidence whatsoever, I think the issue comes down to joy. It's not so much that people reject our truth or our Lord, they reject our joylessness. They do not see us take intense pleasure in our faith or in our community of faith. They're searching for joy in the midst of suffering and difficulties, and we don't have it to offer them. So Massey went on to talk about four signs of joylessness. I know I can relate, see if you can. First, we as Christians spend far too much time criticizing each other, highlighting each other's faults. Blaise Pascal once wrote, I lay down as a fact that if all men knew what others say of them, there would not be four friends in all the world. While conservatives and liberals, evangelicals and mainliners, Catholics and Orthodox, spend our time cataloging faults and convincing ourselves that we serve God by doing it. Too often, what we might call boosterism turns into an attack on others. And we don't even need to look outside our own denomination. We should be better at lending a helping hand to our neighboring United Churches, let alone other denominations. South Mercia, Hillman, just found out this week that we lent them a body. Sharma went to service there this morning, so I made sure she knew that we were praying for them today. As a second point, our joylessness also looks like an exercise of power. Jesus taught us to see leadership as an opportunity to practice servanthood, but we often end up fighting one another. Massey described it this way, if you and I win the church wars, what an absurdly small empire we have won for ourselves. As a third point, our joylessness looks like conflict over worship styles. When we listen to the voices that tell us that it's not worship style, but worship joy that draws people into the living presence of the living God. We've failed God and our people when we make an idol out of any style of worship. Finally, joylessness looks like ineffectiveness. The world is dying for good news, but we get absorbed in our own criticisms and manipulations. We end up with no good news to share. How often have you heard of enthusiastic lay volunteers who enter the committee system of a church and have the joy sucked out of them? Now, this may be one of the real gifts of COVID-19. We're forced by a pandemic to give our volunteers a much-needed rest. We can all appreciate that volunteers can sometimes get very tired. So we look to a future when meaningful and effective service can give joy once more. Someone actually pointed out on Facebook a TV item from, I think it was CTV News, showing Bernice Robinson posting words of encouragement on her home chalkboard just outside the door of her apartment complex. And this little act of spreading joy to fellow residents is her way of spreading joy, keeping awake for Jesus. Maybe you saw that piece. In a few minutes, we'll be remembering the war service of people within our community. Part of keeping awake is honoring the service of those who have gone before. All over the world, people face unrest and uncertainty because of war. And we set November 11th as a day to remember the sacrifice of war veterans. And while we're thankful that Canada has been spared violence, it's important to remember it was not always this way. Peace in our country was purchased at a terrible cost. The dollar figures of war are staggering, but no amount of dollars could bring back those lives. We'll never know how much our country would have gained from the talents and gifts of those sacrificed to the war effort. So keep awake. It's easy to say, and especially with me talking too long, it's hard to do. It's easy to be distracted, and everyone could use an encounter with Jesus. It has to be, as one child put it, a Jesus with skin on. That image might have its problems, but it gets at making Christ real to others. There's another way to miss Jesus, because Jesus comes to us and is, as a church and as individuals, in the face of those we'd call strangers. So I encourage you this week to listen for the message of the strangers who cross your path. They're often the messengers of God. It reminds me of Michael Smith's song lyric. Maybe there are things you just can't know, but can you say there are no mysteries? In the house you choose to dwell, maybe we are entertaining angels unaware. Keep alert. Stand firm in your faith. Be courageous and strong. Let us pray. God, we pray for your deliverance when we become confused and disheartened. We thank you for strength, which is far greater than we thought possible. Thank you for insight when the way seems unclear. We ask today that you walk before us. Amen. Well, I'll invite you to just listen to the words of a song of peace as they get played now. Introduced to you, Dan Eric is going to come and do our reading of the roll. Thank you.
Royal Canadian Legion, Branch 241, Comber Honor Rolls. Comber and area residents that were lost in World War I, 1914 to 1918. Thomas Beattie, Stephen Brown, Ivan Kavanaugh, Theodore Kaza, William Kaza, Gerald Fenner, Walter Holmes, Harvey Kimmerly, Ray Morris, Henry Pearson, Edwin Willen, Russell Willen. Comber and area residents that were lost in World War II, 1939 to 1945, Glenn Atkinson, Roy Green, Carl DeGleish, Vern Elliott, Robert Frankfurth, Leonard Kneister, Norman Malott, Earl Tilson. They shall grow not old, as we that are left grow old. Age shall not weary them, nor the years condemn. At the going down of the sun and in the morning, we will remember them.
We will remember them. I invite you to stand now as we do our moment of remembrance. It's next slide.
Thank you.
You may be seated. Let us unite our hearts in prayer. Let us pray. O Lord, you have promised that if we are, with our hearts we truly seek you, we will surely find you. With all our hearts, we seek you now. Free us from whatever worries and distractions have pursued us here, that we may focus all our power to think and to will, to do on you. We remember the sacrifice of many who have gone before us. Help us to honor that memory by being those who bring peace. We are frail children of time and fate, here today, tomorrow gone. Weak men and women dependent upon your patience. We thank you for your goodness to us. We try more consistently to deserve it. We thank you for treating us better than we deserve. Help us to treat each other in the same way. We bless your blessing on the United States of America as they come to terms with the results of their elections. May this country embrace once again the founding principles of the Christian faith that made their country great. We need your forgiveness, Lord, for we have done things we ought not to have done, and we cannot plead ignorance. We knew what was right and did what we knew was wrong. We ask you to forgive us for what we can hardly forgive ourselves. Create in us clean hearts, clean imaginations. What is in us is dark, illuminate. What is low, raise it up and support. We need your reinforcement. We do not ask to escape sorrows which are a part of life. We ask only assurance that in your divine economy, nothing good is lost. We pray these things in the name of Jesus, your Son and our Savior. Amen. I invite you to listen to, O God, our help in ages past. Save the Queen after our Go Now in Peace. I'm going to invite you to stand for the benediction and we'll remain standing for the Queen. May the mighty God bless and keep you forever. May he give you his strength in every endeavor. May his Spirit always guide and uphold you. And may his love forever enfold you. Go in peace, and the blessing of God the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit go with you. Oh, now in peace. citizen for the Queen.